are face up to the sky. Most of them are over to the side. And this is some church Easter lilies. Isn't that great? So, Easter lilies from church. Don't throw them away. I don't know if she puts the bulbs in the ground all winter or... These are pretty. Those are petunias, aren't they, folks? Now here's one I should have got for you. I'm too late. Oh, this is an amaryllis. An amaryllis, I recognize a leaf. Oh, that was spectacular. I'm too late now. These are sweet, like trumpets. They give their best, don't they? These are white lilies, but they're not Easter lilies, are they? That one just seems to be suspended in midair. Where we burned the trunks of the sumac trees that blew over in the tornado. We burned them and made a big hole, black hole. And then I had to water these. There's a north hole and a south hole. And I had to water these in the morning and in the evening. And this is where the topsoil of the driveway was. And so we distributed the topsoil. And now I have to water that every morning and evening, but not in the last two or three days. We've certainly had enough rain to take care of.
Okay. Did you hear what Harry's favorite pastime is? He plays his wedding videotape backwards so he can see himself walk out of church a free man. 914-949-9495. I never can get a hold of you. Never. It's always a recorder.
That's B-Cat, Kareem Bland, Public Access in Brooklyn. The Public Service Commission number.
The New York State Public Service Commission's opinion line.
chat with Glendora on the internet. It's full screen, just like a TV set. There are 4 half-hour programs on the internet now, and there's 8 more coming. It's up there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And we don't have to put up with a public service commission that ingratiates itself with the money men, the cable operators. We are there, and it's our allodium. It's held in absolute independence. 914-949-945. The site is www.chatwithglendora.com. This is our F-franchisement. That's really what it is. We are F-franchised. From you people who don't take care of us and who ingratiate yourselves with the public, cable operators. Glendora, a chat with Glendora on 44 cable TV stations and 440 municipalities.
This is the loaf of bread that my neighbor Mary made for me. It's oat and some wheat. How does she do it? Every time her bread turns out so beautiful. Want a piece? Want a piece with imperial margarine on it? I cut a piece. It cuts beautifully. This is about the 4th time it's rained today. I think we had rain for 5 days. Let's have some baked beans with our salubrious bread. Salubrious bread. Elizabeth was my teacher, 10 years old today, and she gave me a test on the words from 150 to 238. I don't think I did very well, but she gave me an A. Word 151 is adversative or adverse, and word 238 or 239 is amphictyony. That's a community. Gathering for the protection of a religion. Dora Sassar wanted a list of the 44 TV stations a chat with Glendora is on. And so here it is. And I stapled it all backwards. East Hampton, Amagansett, Montauk, New York, Long Island, far east as you can go. Riverhead, Long Island, Brookhaven, Long Island, Hauppauge, Long Island, Suffolk County, Nassau County, Long Island, Huntington, Islip, and Babylon. Manhattan, New York City, Queens, New York City, Staten Island, New York City. Bronx, New York City, Brooklyn, New York City. Yonkers, Saturdays at 4 p.m. This is Westchester County. We're starting now. New Rochelle and Pelham, Tuesdays, 9:30 p.m. White Plains, Tuesdays, 7 p.m. Greenburg, Tuesdays, 9 p.m. Rye, 10 a.m., 12 p.m., 2 p.m., 4 p.m., 6 p.m., 8 p.m., 10 p.m. every Monday. Larchmont and Mamaroneck, Tuesdays, 9 p.m. Yorktown, Mohegan Lake, Cortland, and about 10 other municipalities up there. Thursday, 6:30 p.m., Channel 22. Harrison, Port Chester, Wednesdays, 9:30 p.m. Ossining, Saturdays at 9 p.m. Pickskill, Saturdays at 9 p.m. Mount Vernon, Thursdays at 6:30 p.m. Rockland County, Tuesdays at 10:30 p.m. Cross River, Westchester County. That covers about 10 municipalities. It's a big signal. Fridays at 7 p.m. 7 to 9 p.m. That's 2 hours long, Cross River. Poughkeepsie, Thursdays, 2:30 p.m. Wappingers Falls, that covers several municipalities. Thursdays at 10 p.m. Wingdale, which is Eastern Dutchess County, Thursdays, 10 p.m. Fairfield County, Connecticut, Fridays, 10:30 p.m. We let 15 minutes go by and we didn't rejoice. God of our fathers, whose almighty hand leads forth in beauty all the starry band of shining worlds in splendor through the sky, our grateful songs before thy throne arise. So we go to the last page. Litchfield, Connecticut, Saturdays at 2 p.m. Bergen County, New Jersey, Mondays at 10:30 p.m. Buffalo, New York, Mondays at 6:30 p.m. Santa Fe, New Mexico. I don't know when, and you're bad, Doreen Ortiz, that you will not call me back and tell me. You're bad. Los Alamos, New Mexico, Tuesdays, 2 p.m. And Jean John Rowe, you're good. And Portland, Oregon, Sundays, 7 p.m. These are the times and days that A Chat with Glendora is on in 44 TV stations around the country. Internet, www.achatwithglendora.com. Every day of the week and every hour of the week. And we have our own channel. You don't have to put down an hour. And you don't have to put down a day. And you don't have to put down a channel. First Aaron was the Stockport Garage. They did not have, he didn't have time to put on the belt, the fan belt. It makes too much noise. And Ford, for 3 weeks, haven't got in the valve that's supposed to stop this noise when the brakes come on and off. Martha Stewart was sentenced to 5 months and a $30,000 fine. That's really nothing compared to like Elena Sassauer, who was standing up for America, who never did any of the things that she was charged with. She never disrupted Congress. And she was sentenced to 6 months. And this was a felony, alleged. Well, their lawyer is going to appeal it on 5 points. That a juror committed perjury, a government witness committed perjury, and that there was no insider trading. I'm just sorry. I'm just sorry. But good will come out of it. So the first errand was a Stockport garage. The second errand was the Stockville post office. The third errand was gasoline, $1.99. I should have taken a picture of it for you. And the fourth errand was getting the laundry into the washer, and that's where the TV was telling about Martha Stewart, and she held a press conference saying that she didn't feel sorry for herself, but just for the people in her company, that over 200 people had lost their jobs. Fifth errand is save a lot.
Exquisite. Exquisite. And look at the red ones. Red lilies. Red lilies. And an orange one. Isn't it sweet? That's the building I showed you in its underwear. Well, it still is in its underwear. It's a big building. They made considerable progress. Folks, I wanted to show you this one-lane bridge. One-lane bridge. See, there's the lower falls. I would like to see those from the front. And that goes to the upper falls that we've seen so many times. But this is a one-lane bridge. Goodbye videotaping, hello editing, and at 5:30 a.m. rejoice that we have public access. Editing is about to begin. Prediction, 12 hours. Thank you people, thank you God. If you're sorry for Martha Stewart, and for all of the other people involved. And I wish that they would be. As happy as you and I are. Amen. Now thank we all our God with hearts and minds and voices who from our who wondrous things have done, in which the world rejoices, who from our mother's arms have sent us on our way with countless gifts of love, and still are ours today.
Thank you, God, for this new day. And thank you, God, for yesterday. And give them this day their daily bread.
Us in person or order any number of unpleasant experiences by phone. It's Late Night with David Letterman. Tonight, Rob Reiner, cable TV talk show host Glendora, and comedian Rich Neidner, plus Paul Schaefer and the NBC Orchestra. And now, a guy who likes salad as much as the next guy. Unless the next guy is named Mr. Giant Bunny, David Letterman!
And the show was so much fun and just so good. It was white hot, and as a result, we didn't really have enough time, the fair amount of time to devote to this woman. So she consented to be over on the show tonight, stayed over. Her name is Glendora, and she is here tonight. As I'm explaining that, I can hear my a voice in my head saying, "Dave, you're just full of hot gas." And now, what was that? Speaking of hot gas, well, thank you very much. What's next here? Top 10 category tonight in the top 10 list from the home. Glendora will be here, and also comedian Rich Scheidner. Tomorrow on the program, tomorrow is another great show. I don't know who's putting the show together, but this one is another solid gold program. Paul, you don't have any Rolaids, do you?
I can send out for some.
Yeah, do you mind?
Yeah, I'll send out.
I feel like I'm having a little trouble here tonight.
What could cause a thing like that?
I don't know. Anyway, on the program tomorrow, Sugar Ray Leonard will be here. Mm. And also from the Grateful Dead, Jerry Garcia and Bob Weir. That'll be tomorrow night. Now, let's just bring out Glendora, shall we? Okay. My next guest believes in using television to spread her own special brand of happiness. She has made over 100 commercials. We have an example of one right here.
Hey, folks. How are you today? Just miserable, right? This is Glendora for delicious Worthington VeggieLinks. VeggieLinks by Worthington, folks, have no cholesterol. Delicious VeggieLinks have fewer calories than regular hot dogs, and VeggieLinks have no preservatives. I have no preservatives either. You see the wrinkles? Get your delicious VeggieLinks at the Glendora Health Nook at...
No need to shop everywhere. Go straight to Twin Fair.
And her show, A Chat with Glendora, has featured guests like Robert C. Wright, the president of NBC. Folks, please welcome the happiness lady, Glendora. Glendora, how are you? Pleasure to see you. Please have a seat. Where are you from, Glendora? Where does this show take place? Where can people see this?
Oh, The Chat with Glendora?
Yeah.
You can see this on Manhattan Cable TV and Paragon Cable TV, and mm-hmm. you can also see it in Westchester, where all the rich people live, United Artists Cable.
And from where does it originate?
Well, of course, we originated at Mr. Wright's office and at Madeline Smithberg's dressing room and at Mr. and the chairman of General Foods and the chairman of Nestle's. We originated in people's offices. Uh-huh. Some people come to our home, David.
I see.
The chairman of Colgate-Palmolive P came to our home.
How do you get all of these people
at 7 a.m.?
Yeah. And I guess you were steamed, huh, that he was there so early?
Well, the thing that interested me about him, David, was that he did his own marketing research, and he went through all of our cupboards to see if we had any Colgate-Palmolive products.
Mm-hmm. And what did the research turn up?
Zero.
Zero.
He didn't look under the sink cupboard where he would have found something. He didn't go into the bathroom cupboard. Yeah. He really would have found something.
Now, tell me about the show. What is the format? When somebody tunes in, what do they see?
They see where were you born, where'd you go to school, what were your jobs, what is your present work like, mm-hmm. and what advice would you give a youngster to get started on such a career today?
So it's an interview show primarily.
Yes, that's what we asked Mr. Wright.
Yeah. A half-hour show, is it?
Yes, isn't it amazing what the public will stand?
Uh-huh. And is it on once a week?
Yeah, oh yes.
And how many years have you been on the air?
Well, I've been on television 35 years, but that show's been on the air a year and three quarters. Mm-hmm.
Are you hoping that this particular show will maybe grow, perhaps expand, maybe get to a network status or a local TV station or something?
Well, I sort of doubt that.
You don't think that'll happen?
No.
You sure have the wardrobe for it, you know? Now let's take a look. Show me some of the footage. This is Robert Wright, the president
Lord, yeah.
of NBC. You know, how did you get this guy to be on the show? Because we've asked him for years and years.
Have you?
Oh, yeah, and he won't come on the show. How did you get him?
It must be my good looks, huh?
Yeah.
Except I did talk to him over the phone, so that wouldn't help.
Uh-huh.
No, I figure this way, David. He's a nice man, and he does want to help the youth. And that's what this is all about.
He wants to help the youth.
Yeah, that's what this problem...
Have we heard anything about that? He wants to help the youth? Paul, did you hear anything about Robert Wright wanting to help the youth of this country?
Robert C. Wright?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he wants to help the youth.
I think he just... I think he's just looking to balloon the stock prices. I think that's about all we're into here.
No, he's a very nice man.
Very nice man. All right, now let's take a look at a couple of seconds from his interview on your show, okay?
Okay,
we have that here? Yeah. Robert C. Wright and Glendora. Helping the youth. It is a chat with Glendora.
And then we got General Electric acquired RCA. And then I came over from General Electric to become the president of NBC. And that's how I got here.
Oh, it's such an interesting career. And that's how you ended up in Fairfield, because I think General Electric Cable was centered in Fairfield, wasn't it?
Yes, I actually never worked in Fairfield.
Oh, you never did?
No, I've worked... most recently, my office was in Stamford, Connecticut, before I came here.
Oh.
Although I live in that area, but I didn't work there.
I see, yeah. This is Mr. Robert C. Wright, who is the president and chief executive officer of NBC, and he'll be back in just a second and tell you what his work is like, to see if you'd like to aim for that as a career, and then he'll also give you some ideas how to get started in broadcasting in today's world.
It seems like you and he were dressed alike. Didn't he? You sort of have the same kind of look there. Now, I don't want to linger on this, but how did General Electric's acquisition of RCA, how did that ultimately help the youth of this country?
What helped the youth was Mr. Wright telling how he got started, because he was at the same point. Yeah, he was at the same point in his development as the youth who watch the program. We hope are in theirs.
I see. Now tell me about your personal recipe for happiness. You're known as the happiness lady.
Well,
is that what they say?
No.
What do they call you?
Glendora.
Yeah.
And what did you say your name was?
I'm Dave.
No.
My last night.
You are a very good interviewer.
Well, thank you.
And I'm going to recommend you for a raise.
Thank you.
the recipe for happiness, David, is that there's one thing in this world that you can do better than anybody else. And if you will go by yourself, you will find out what that is. And you will do it, and you'll be happy. Now, if you don't do it, David, it's going to nag at you every second of your life.
So you find out what it is that you're good at.
No, the one thing that you can do better than anybody else.
The one thing you can do better than anyone else, and you just concentrate on that.
Yes, you do.
And then that'll make you happy.
Well, sure, because you'll get everything you want.
Yeah. And the Vegalinks, vegetable protein, no meat at all in here, right?
No meat.
Okay. All right. Well, geez, Glendora, good luck with the show.
Oh, thank you very much.
And I hope you can come back and see us again sometime.
Oh, we'd like to very much. Would that take 2 days or just one the next time?
I don't know. Oh, that's right. You were supposed to be here last night. Okay. We have to go here now. We have other guests. But thank you very much. Nice to see you.
Universal, the studio that brought you all...
I've got a great job. Money in the bank. Last month, someone asked if I read the Bible. The Bible? I'm successful. I'm happy. What do I need the Bible for? I can get more from the Wall Street Journal. But that made me curious. So I decided to take a second look.
I'm on my feet all day. When I go home, I just want to turn on the TV and relax. But read the Bible? All those these and thous and begats? Who wants to struggle with that after waiting on customers all day? But then a friend showed me this version written in modern English, and I was surprised.
This guy I play hoops with said I should start reading it, the Bible. Man, I said, I don't need no Bible. I mean, it just ain't cool. So he goes, I read it all the time. And he beat me by 20 points. So he gives me his Bible. I read it. It ain't hoops, but it ain't bad.
What's your excuse? Before you make an excuse to avoid reading the Bible, stop. Take a second look. Pick up the Bible for 5 minutes, and you may pick it up for a lifetime.
Opposing the implementation of new local...
I want to see a mess. This is a mess. Well, I shouldn't say that. I glorify that this is brilliant work and that we edited yesterday. It took 15 hours. 15 hours is every hour of a working day. There's 16 hours in a working day, 8 hours of sleep. It took 15 hours to edit. And there were 12 editions, 12 half-hour editions, and about 50 tapes in all. Here's some of them that wouldn't even fit into the mailing box. I haven't been able to, the errands were a success, but I haven't been able to put away yet. You do errands, you do two things after that when you come home. You unload the car and you put away. Well, put away isn't done since Friday night. But it's a great thing. It's a great thing. And now what is going on? No, it was just finished. I do three special editions, one for Berkshire, one for Chatham, and one for a Washington, D.C. Those are three special editions. Those got done for the programs of July 3rd. And now got to do the same thing for the programs of July 17th that were edited yesterday. On the way to church this morning, folks, right in the middle of the main road, right on the yellow line, was a raccoon who'd been slaughtered. And I said to myself, I cannot pick up that animal. I will be late for church. But that's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. So I pulled over, turned around, went back and parked. And I carry a towel to keep my feet from getting the rug dirty in the driver's pad. And so I use that towel for his burying cloth. Boy, I gotta keep my raccoon from going into the yard, into the road. And my skunk. Because the poor little fella, he was just looking for something to eat. He was just hungry. That's not a fatal sin, is it? I got an assignment at church today, folks. I got to take pictures at like Vacation Bible School, digital pictures, not movie pictures. Five days, starting the last week of July, 9 to 12, I got to take pictures. I got summoned because I have my video camera in church. Today I didn't videotape any of the church music. Church is a good bet. It's a good place to go. It's good. You'd be surprised how much it helps you. Let's see. The hairs of your head are numbered, and Bob says it's getting easier to take the inventory every year. And the clerk says the judge and I have a good relationship, pure and simple. I'm pure and he's simple. And the judge never loses his temper. He can always find it when he needs it. And if you're having an argument with a boss, folks, it's best to look at both sides, his side and the outside. And the boss is, the judge is temperamental, 50% temper and 50% mental. And another judge is suffering from Moon Syndrome. You know what Moon Syndrome is? You carry 1/6 of the weight you think you do. And the way Charles Dolan holds his meetings, he presents his proposals and he says all in favor say aye and all opposed say bye. And you heard about the CEO who brought his company from obscurity to anonymity. And when the clerk came out of the judge's office, the secretary said, "Well, did the judge give you a piece of his mind?" And the clerk says, "Yes, he did." And that's amazing when you consider how low the inventory is. So what do you have to do today? Call me up and tell me. I try to write the biography of Glendora 15 minutes a day to put up on the internet. And you go back and you read it, and it's kind of funny, the things that have happened. It really makes you laugh. And so some words. Let's find some words, folks. Let's take words 181 to 190. Let's see if I can say them to you. Agnosticism. Agnosticism is a belief that the origin of the universe is unknown, is unknowable. And then comes Agnus Dei, the Lamb of God. And then comes agonic, not forming an angle. And let's see. And then comes what? Is that aggravate and aggregate? I don't think so. An agglomerate. Judges agglomerate. They form themselves into a ball. Aggrandize. Doing something for your own preferment or your own honor or power or riches or wealth. And judges do that. In fact, I never knew a judge who didn't. How many judges do you think I know? At least 100, right? I've sued at least 100, haven't I? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, because every lawsuit that goes out has about 25 defendants in it, so it must be way over 100 judges I've sued. Let's see. I had these all wrong, I think. Agonic. Oh, here's a word I hate. Agonize. I won't even stop and give you the definition of that. Agrarian, having to do with the fields or with farming. And, I know, here's one of our favorite words, I think, in this group, 186. Yeah, aim. Aim, to direct one's endeavors to the accomplishment of a purpose. Isn't that a great one? Aim, to direct one's endeavors to the achievement of a purpose. And after that comes alacrity. Yeah, isn't that a nice word? Nimbleness. I've lost that a long time ago. Nimbleness, quick and moving. It has other good definitions, just a minute. Agility. These are words 181 to 190, 186. A cheerful readiness. What did I say? Agility? I should have been talking about alacrity. A cheerful readiness. Or promptitude. Or briskness. Isn't that nice? What time is it? We missed our 11:30 rejoice. Remember? We rejoice every 15 minutes about something. Okay, what will we rejoice about? We should show a promptitude on our rejoicing every 15 minutes. Everybody I tell that to has a wonderful reaction. They sort of smile and say, yeah. Try to rejoice about something every 15 minutes and be better at it than I am. And after alacrity comes a la mode. And then comes alliance, I believe. Would that be right? And then comes allocution. Alliance is a great thing. See, if this doesn't make you think of God, alliance, just a minute. There's a nice definition. Some of these words you say, oh yeah, those are common words. I know what those mean. But an alliance is nice. It's a formation of a partnership or a relationship for mutual advantage. And then there's alas, alas, pure, poor Yorick. An exclamation expressing sorrow, pity, or apprehension of evil. Now, I don't like that. It's just alas, an expression of sorrow or pity. Or maybe just apprehension. And then the last one, I guess it's alchemy. Alchemy really appeals to me because these people in the Middle Ages were devoted to trying to find the cure for all diseases. They were trying to find how to have life everlasting. They were trying to find how you turn the baser metals into gold. It really appeals to me. Not changing baser metals into gold, but the idea of curing all diseases, that appeals to me. Does it to you? Okay. So we started another 2-week cycle. We got that big job I told you to go out. I got to make those 3 editions for Washington, D.C., for Chatham, and for Berkshire of all of the things. Pick it out of all of the 12 half hours, the 12 editions. Pick them all out and put them on one tape for Berkshire and all of Chatham News on the Chatham tape. And all of the Washington, D.C. news from the Washington, D.C. tape. I have to write a motion for to proceed without payment of fees to the appellate term for Glendora versus Dolan, Charles Dolan, and Cablevision Systems Corporation, which Peter Blaine made such a mess out of, and Robert Callaghan made such a mess out of, and lied and cheated and manipulated, ambush and ambage is what it was. And I have to continue writing the Dolan Harrison, Glendora versus Charles F. Dolan, Cablevision Systems Corporation, and James L. Dolan, and Charles Former, and Thomas Garger, and Mac Budill, and Christine Savarino, and Peggy Anderson, and Cecilia Mastrulli for violating our public access rights in Harrison. A chat with Glendora hasn't been on there for 3/4 of a year. And then I have to finish writing Kahnbaum, who thinks he can sue me for libel or slander. And then I have to write to the realtors where Natalia and Preferred Properties, Preferred Country Properties in Chatham, violated the realtor's code. I haven't even got to the code yet. There's been so many violations just of the preamble alone. And then open the in-mail, and that'll be more. More calls. That have to be answered with what? Alacrity, cheerful readiness. What else? It would be nice to eat. Keep the animals fed. Put away the groceries. What do you think I should do about the internet now? 4, 8, 12 programs. Half an hour each. 4 I know are up, and 8 should be in the process of being up. And now I have 12 more half hours. Should we put those on the internet for the whole world to see? Oh, I left out one big project. Is the either I'm going to write a notice of appeal with attachment to the Chicago court for the terrible things they did to America. His name is Norgle, N-O-R-G-L-E. Or I'm going to write a Rule 60B motion for relief from order. If I do that, Rule 60B that stops the appeals clock. And that might give me time to save up for the appeals fee. Folks, there shouldn't be any fees in courts. You shouldn't have to pay fees to go to court. Courts belong to the public. Why do we have to pay fees? And one thing I'd like to point out is that Chicago and San Francisco and those appeals courts to the west, they're saying you have to pay $255 to file an appeal. In our part of the country, here in the east, we pay $105. And the law says clearly that the fees will be set by the Judicial Council, and those fees have to be the same in every appeals court. So if they're $105 in my court, then they're breaking the law charging $255 in their court. So maybe we can get up to $105. All those are much more altruistic things you can use it for. Wouldn't you like to be an almoner? A-L-M-A-N-E-R. Should look it up. And go out and give money gratuitously to relieve the poor. Wouldn't you like to do that? Okay, this is Glendora, chat with Glendora on 44 TV stations. And that would come out to about 440 municipalities, and it comes out to also being on the internet 24 hours a day, all over the world, 7 days a week, at www.achatwithglendora.com. Let me know if I can help you folks, you know, because you're meant to be happy. Yep. Now, folks, you recall a long time ago that I wrote to Chairman William Donaldson of the Securities Exchange Commission and told him that Cablevision refused to show me the books, records, and minutes 107 times. 107 times! And so something's wrong, okay? Something's going on there. And I'm a shareholder, and I have every right to see that by New York state law and by Delaware business corporation law. And so something is going on. Cablevision is trying to cover up something. So I told Chairman Donaldson of the SEC that I wanted Cablevision investigated because I suspected there's an Enron here. Well, now this is 2-3 months ago. Okay? And nobody has got back to me. And I've called about 10 times, and this is about what happens. I just want you to know that people in the government don't work for the people. This isn't going to get the job done, so let us fast forward here.
Can you help me with that?
Okay.
Tell me, spell your last name.
Glendora.
Miss Glendora. Mm-hmm.
It's okay.
Miss Glendora, if you have a complaint, as you do, you need to speak with someone else's office, who is Susan Glendora, and I can transfer you to her inspection.
No, that's not what I want. I want Chairman Donaldson to read my letter.
Okay.
That's not what I want.
Any correspondence is forwarded to another office for the chairman?
That's not what I want. Okay? I want Chairman Donaldson to read my letter.
Okay.
Now, this is going on the internet. I have a TV show and it's on the internet. And the way that this is being treated.
Give me an opportunity to explain to you because I really need to get you to where you need to speak with
me. And that's Chairman Donaldson and nobody else.
Okay. You'll have to call back.
Okay.
Okay, folks, interesting, isn't it? That's the Securities Exchange Commission, Washington, D.C. I want the chairman to investigate Cablevision because I suspect it's an Enron, because Cablevision refused 107 times to show me, a shareholder, the books, records, and minutes. We have 9 legal papers to work on every day for a while. Work on each one 15 minutes a day. This is the internet, which is a new thing. Work on that 15 minutes a day. What do you think about this plan to put an index table of contents up there? For instance, program 33,809, edition 1 is God Bless America, and many other patriotic songs on July 4th, and 3,810 edition 2 is July 4th parade. 3,811-3 is the mess that Clavert made out of Glendora standing up for America, his dis-Americanism. Clavert is a United States District Judge in Milwaukee. And then why don't we just drop a note to Clavert and say you can see this on the internet at show number 3,811, the third edition. You think that's a good idea? And show 3,812-4 concerns Clavert, Milwaukee, the Eastern District of New York, Brooklyn, that's Carol Ahman, Ralph Vega, and Robert Heinemann, and Mississippi, dis-Americanism, and New Orleans dis-Americanism, and show number 3,913, fifth edition, is hymns and jokes, and the Rye, about the Rye Court, about the Indianapolis, about Chatham hiring an Indianapolis lawyer to defend him, about the Federal Reserve Bank, and Kevin Bailey. Is an interview with him, or rather a chat with Glendora with him. And show number 3,814, edition 6, is Greene County Animal Welfare. and about Cross River tapes, and Andrew Herzman about the internet, and show number 3,815, seventh edition, is Perry Jones, a man of God, about Manchester, Connecticut, and Connecticut bad? What is that about? Oh, Cox. Oh, yes. About Manchester. Yeah, you've known for a long time that Cox Cable TV in Manchester, Connecticut is antithetical to the whole spirit of public access, the people communicating with one another, and antithetical to the public forum that public access is. That would be Lori Badanani and the general manager, and then the Cox CEO down in Atlanta. And so this has gone on for a year that they blocked out a chat with Glendora with no statutory authority, with no facts, and with no law. So that's Manchester, Connecticut. And we've spent a lot of money, time, and labor to try to bring these people to wake them up. So how about Andy Herzman's show is on in Manchester, England. So why don't we just drop Manchester, Connecticut and take Manchester, England. Andy Herzman is going to work on that. So that's the internet. Now here's the next 12 programs. There are 12 programs on the internet already. Here's 12 more. So what do you say we get those ready to go out? This is internet 4, 5, and 6. What do you think? Thomas Goodman gave me a lot of insight. He's a he's my first internet fan. A young man in Staten Island. He gave me my first response to the webcasting. So we have Glendora's in broadcast TV, cablecast TV, and now webcast TV. One picketer was carrying a sign that said, "Time heals all wounds." And the picketer behind him carried a sign that said, "Yeah, but time and a half heals them faster." We got back on TV in Harrison. And I wish to thank all of my faithful and loyal friends who worked so hard to make that happen. And it starts tonight, it resumes tonight at 9:30 p.m. So rejoice, 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 rejoice. And thank you all for doing that. This is a videotape that came in from George McDermott, in which he covers in Los Angeles the convention of ACORN International. And ACORN International is taking a vigorous stand against predatory lenders. Predatory lenders are coddled by the courts. It's easy to figure out why, right? Because the courts partake. And George McDermott is a victim of that. And so are a few other poor people I know, victims of it. And I have the footage of a lady's speech about predatory lending, and we have to stop it. It goes on with the consent of the courts, and I've told you why. George is doing a wonderful job standing up for Elena Sassauer. Elena Sassauer knew that an appointee, a New York judge, state judge named Wesley, was up for ratification by the Congress to be a United States Circuit Judge, Court of Appeals. And she knew this man to be unfit, in fact, to be dangerous and to be harmful to you, getting justice. So she went down to Congress to oppose the ratification. And she never got a chance to speak. This is a terrible thing, folks. You have nothing to say about the judges who go on to the federal bench. You have nothing to say about it. And so the Shandis, the Senate Judiciary Committee, one senator now, not even a majority there. When Elena put the gavel down, it was over. Elena never had a chance to speak, and so Elena asked to speak. And so Shandis picked up a prepared statement and said, "Will the police restore order?" And the police went over and arrested her. Well, as Elena was saying, as she was being dragged out, "Did you direct that I be arrested?" And she asked him four times, and he wouldn't answer. So these hoods went ahead, I guess, and arrested her on their own. And then the U.S. attorney charged her with disrupting Congress. Well, we have a videotape of it. She did not disrupt Congress. And she was on trial for 6 days. All of her civil rights were violated. Anything she wanted to say to the jury, the judge named Brian Holman had a squelch box, and he squelched it, and the jury never heard it. And then all of the discovery that Elena needed to prosecute her case successfully, all of these cops said, "Oh, we don't know what happened to him. We don't know." Now, these are professionals, okay? Professionals do not lose court papers. So the whole thing was a frame-up, and Brian Holman, U.S. attorney, recommended only 2 days in jail, and Brian Holman, the judge, gave her 6 months in jail. Because one, she refused to give up her constitutional rights. Two, she refused to apologize to Congress. And three, she refused to take anger management classes. So George McDermott is rightfully perturbed about this. And folks, he went to Congress and he tried to see the people and tell them about it so that they would do something. And this letter is to Justin R. Brass of the State of the Select Committee on Ethics for the United States Senate. Dear sir, encloses a television schedule for the DC channel. That's for a chat with Glendora on DC. I guess my copy's somewhere else. Called A Chat with Glendora, which features an interview with a citizen activist, Elena Sassauer, who is now locked up in the D.C. jail, compliments of the United States Senate Judiciary Committee and its ranking members who are responsible for the frame-up illegal incarceration and the most outrageous display of ethical and legal misconduct. I hope you and your staff will now understand why I was in your office today seeking information on filing formal legal complaints against Senators Saxby Chambliss, C-H-A-M-B-B-L-I-S-S, and other co-conspirators in the U.S. Senate responsible for the wrongful incarceration of this fellow citizen. I'm very serious about filing criminal charges against these senators and staff members. I have them down. I have Chambliss down and Brian Holman down on my next who to sue list. I know it's not grammatical, but it rhymes. And they're there. And so I am working on that. And of course, you will see the beautiful consummation of that. That'll be Omnibus 23. Now, first legal paper of this two-week period is United States District Court for the Eastern District of Wisconsin, Milwaukee. Where they have such a good time drinking beer. And I focus on a judge named Charles N. Clavert, Jr. And my first step on that is to say that the United States District Court in Milwaukee violates the United States Code, the filing fee for U.S. Courts of Appeal shall be the same in all circuits. Our circuit, the Second Circuit, and the First and the Third and the Fourth and the Fifth and the 11th, the filing fee for an appeal is $105, and they think that they can charge $255. So right off the bat, Congress, you have a bunch of judges who ratified breaking the United States Code. Further, in June, Judicial Council put the whole pro se filing appeal changes on the back burner, and George McDermott was there. Isn't that a wonderful thing? He covered that. Now, here is their letter to Glendora telling her what the steps are to go to the U.S. Court of Appeals. There are no minutes because there was no trial because due process was strangled to death. Clavert stepped down from being a judge to being a defense counsel. The defendants never appeared. Never appeared. And he argues their case for them. The judge argues the case for the defendants. Now this will be reported on Glendora's show on the internet all over the world. Voila. So there are some choice Anglo-Saxon comments on the paper from that court. And then Glendora repeats that you cannot charge $255 for the fee for appealing, because the fee has to be the same in all the circuits. And in our circuit,
it's $105. This is a transcript request, $5 a page for a page half empty. No, man, no way. Well, there is no transcript because Claveret just violated due process and summarily dismissed this great lawsuit, Glendora versus John M. Walker. John M. Walker, by the way, is the chief judge of the Second Circuit. Now, here is Glendora's notice of appeal. And when Glendora files a notice of appeal, she always files it with an attachment and says, notice to the clerk, make certain attachment with notice of appeal goes to the Seventh Circuit. Now, the United States District Court in Milwaukee sent back my $105 money order, and so I'm sending it back to them because it's illegal for them to charge $255. The charge has to be the same in all the circuits. Now, what am I appealing? I know that you know because I read it to you. It was three papers. And as I said in these papers, Clavert's record was bad enough before he did this. He didn't need any more help. He was bad enough as it was. But here's what I made a motion for, folks. This was a motion for Rule 60B, relief from order. He dismissed my case. Rule 60B says that I can ask him to relieve me from that order. Or return my $150 that he took as a filing fee in the United States District Court. Return that to me because it was consumer fraud. He didn't do his job. Or keep the appeals fee at $105 where our circuits have it. Or enlarge the appeal time to give Glendora time to save up for another ripoff, $150, making it $255. Or grant Title 28, U.S. Code, Section 1915, in form of pauperous relief, filing as a poor person and not having to pay any fees. Or for the Seventh Circuit to grant Glendora in form of pauperous. You know what Bob's favorite pastime is? Playing his wedding videotape backwards so he can see himself walk out of church a free man. My first internet fan called. His name is Thomas Goodman. Isn't that a nice name? Goodman. And we talked for half an hour last night, and he's a knowledgeable young man, and he's got all of his information off the internet about Glendora, and he knows more about Glendora than I do. So it was nice to hear from him. He and his friend Lewis, L-U-I-S, work on Glendora on the internet, sort of jointly. This is the United States Court of Appeals for the Seventh Circuit, and this is called a docketing statement. And it says Glendora Appellant versus John M. Walker et al. Appellees are about 35 defendants, all judges and clerks, for the most part. The jurisdiction of the district court. The district court had jurisdiction as a civil action arising under the laws of the United States personal in Title 42 U.S. Code, Section 1983. That's civil rights. They violated my civil rights, all these defendants, in this lawsuit, along with Clavert, who was just worse than any defendant. And Section 1985, which is conspiracy. They all conspired to defeat this justice for the United States of America. It really comes down to traitorship, you know.
This appeal is taken from the final decision of the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of Wisconsin, entered on 6/22/04 by the head Honorable Charles N. Clavert, Jr. I crossed out the Honorable. The United States Court of Appeals has jurisdiction to decide this case pursuant to blank, U.S. Code blank. And so I called up the U.S. Court of Appeals in Chicago and said, how do I fill that in? And the first pro se clerk didn't really know, and beat around, maybe I should play you that conversation. No, I'll just tell you about it. And I said, okay, but that still doesn't fill in the blank. And then there was some more of that, and I repeated that it didn't fill in the blank. She said, one moment, please, and a boy. Pro se clerk came on, and he said, he was sort of ambiguous too, circumlocution, he was all over the place, and I said, well, the last time I called this Court of Appeals to find out about that, I was told that I didn't have to fill that in, and he says, pro ses do not have to fill this in. And so I wrote that onto the docketing statement. The notice of appeal was filed with the district court on 6/9/04, anno domini, and is stated today, July the 21st, Columbia County, New York, in Glendora. Alrighty. And this is the district court's fact sheet. Now, I want you to see all of the lawbreakers that this Clavert let go. That this Clavert, this U.S. District Judge in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, all of the people, all of the lawbreakers that he covered for. Okay, that was a little quarter of a page? All right, how about this whole page? You notice they're not represented. You notice they never appeared. And I made a motion for default, which I was 100% entitled to get. But what did Clavert do? Covers up for the crooks. That was two pages. How about this third one? Here is the docket sheet. As U.S. District Courts go, this court does the best job. The best judge, clerk's job. And they may do the best job of covering up the evil that's being done to the United States of America. Docket. It has very few mistakes as these things go. However, I annotated every page. And one page just had this on it. And so I asked, what is this? Now, what you read here, I tell the United States District Court in Milwaukee, is being read on Glendora's TV show on the internet all over the world. Voila. www.achatwithglendora.com. The estimated time of I guess when the show is to appear on the internet is the first week of August. The estimated title is Milwaukee Clavert, Second Appeal. It will probably be show number circa 3,822, second edition, and up July 31st is when these shows will be edited. This is Opus 1179.
It took 4 hours. And it cost them $12.14 for postage. I included, this is the service list, folks. Who gets a copy? Clavert, the clerk, the United States Court of Appeals for the Seventh Circuit, Glendora TV audience, that's you, you're the most important one on the list, and Glendora Internet audience, and who to sue, and McDermott and the Center for Judicial Accountability, Incorporated, that's Selena's organization, and MECOM, the so-called administrator of U.S. courts, and Orrin Hatch, who's the chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee, who ratifies such bad judges to go on the bench, and the House Judiciary Committee, and to George Bush, the president. Not for long, I hope. Now, Saffron B. Nedelsky is the clerk of this court, United States District Court, Milwaukee. And Glendora says that he leads all the U.S. courts in clerkship. His papers are beautifully done, and give him a raise. The rules, 77, 78, 79, that's what the clerk put on here. So, big paper, it was carefully done. You know how long it took? It must have taken 5 hours. It takes half of a day. Okay, let's go. I should have brought you out some jokes. Let's see if I can remember them. Bob's favorite pastime is playing his wedding videotape backwards so he can see himself walk out of church a free man. And the little girl says, Daddy, does a husband boss the house? And Daddy says, no, honey, the husband houses the boss. And what other jokes are on there? No two people think alike until it comes to wedding presents. Now Bob and Joan got some very nice shower. They had a shower, a wedding shower. And they got some very nice wedding presents. They got many things that said his and hers. And they got one thing that said us, a United States Army blanket. Did you hear about the couple who got married so late in life that Medicare picked up 80% of the honeymoon? I don't have a list. I don't have the energy to get up and go get it. So I'll tell you some other jokes. Harry was talking to God, and Harry says, God, how much is $1 million to you? And God said, $10. And Harry says, well, God, how long is 1 million years to you? And God said, a second. And Harry says, God, can you loan me $10? And God said, certainly, just a second. Okay, folks, I'm going to sleep right in front of the camera, so let's go to bed. Keep the courage flaming. The hope is that these judges, when they see the crimes they have committed against America, when they see them on the internet and know that you, all over the world, have seen them, and that you know, that they will know that you know, and that will stop them. You think that's so? It's a good thing that this is television and not smell-o-vision, because that was a load of manure that just went from one farm to another. See how nice it is to live in the country? I told you about my alma mater, American International College in Springfield, Massachusetts, and they're having they have a radio station, WAIC radio reunion, and in their newsletter they featured Bob Hope and told about Glendora. Fresh out of college, too fresh, Glendora went to work for NBC Hollywood. This afforded the opportunity to meet such greats as Bob Hope, Groucho Marx, Jack Benny, Red Skelton, and Dinah Shore. The salary afforded little else. Glendora hosted TV shows for over 14 years. It always amazed us how much the public would stand. All in all, she says, I've been in television 50 years. And you can verify this by counting the rings under my eyes. So, we'll send them a small donation, $4, again. This is the New York State Commission on Judicial Conduct, Lee Kai Clear, or Kicklier, how would you pronounce it? Says thank you for the complaint about the judge, and we're acknowledging that we received it, and your complaint will be processed will be presented to the commission, but please note that the commission has no jurisdiction over federal judges. Well, Glendora says, yes, I know that, and this is how come I have filed 50 judicial misconduct and disability complaints against federal judges whose conduct is prejudicial to the effective and efficacious administration of the business of the courts, Title 28 U.S. Code, Section 352. What federal judge complaint was sent to you? Stearns, Boston, Clavert, Milwaukee, Norgal, Chicago. The business of the courts is justice, by the way. And these courts have been out of business for a long time. Computers are in the Bible. Eve said to Adam, do you want an apple too?
from the Staten Island Advance, Tuesday, July 6th. Community television elects new president. And her name is Esposito Maria. And it tells about the dissatisfaction of the public access producers with community TV in Staten Island, and that's been going on for years. Also, Staten Island doesn't do enough public access. For years, they have tried to stifle it. And it quotes Molinaro at great length. And they fired Luke. And that's bad. That's very bad to fire Luke. And the way they did it was dehumanized. You've lost your title. These are things we don't have to put up with on the network, on the internet. So watch this carefully and see what happens. Chat with Glendora is on community TV in Staten Island. That's a Time Warner system. The public access is run by the borough. And they don't treat people right. They don't treat the public access producers correctly. Or humanly. Or humanely or whatever. Folks, yesterday I talked to Cecilia at Cablevision in Pigskill. And it turned out a terribly long list of things to do. So I started working on them. And she was going to call Yonkers and see how many tapes they had. And she was going to call Wappingers and see how many tapes they had. And Yorktown is taken care of. They have 40 tapes, and it takes $8.50 approximately to send back 40 tapes. And I sent that to Yorktown, so that's all taken care of. Pigskill, Cecilia said she had a whole bunch of tapes, so I sent her $8.35, or 50 cents, whatever. And then Tony Muley in Yonkers, turned renegade and will not sign for a chat with Glendora and Yonkers anymore. And so we wanted to know how many tapes there were in Yonkers so we could know how much postage is sent Yonkers. And then Wappingers had tapes and she didn't know how many they had. Cecilia didn't know how many they had. So I did some of these things. I sent $8.50, or it's in a letter to mail, to Yonkers. Tabat has turned in her papers, so we're all set in Pigskill. And we're working on getting a new signer in Yonkers. Yonkers has always been a horrible problem. And so I called up today to tell Cecilia that I had sent or had ready to send $8.25 to Yonkers. And she doesn't know how many tapes there are in Yonkers. So I said, okay, then I'll send the $8.25 to Wappingers. And she doesn't know how many tapes there are in Wappingers. Oh, well, let me just play you this conversation. No matter how you look at it, folks, you cannot get along with Cablevision. You just cannot get along with Cablevision. Listen to this. Cablevision insane.
sent in the form for the recycle tape, so now you're mailing them back, so I'm confused.
Oh, okay. Well, we're talking about Yonkers.
Okay.
I didn't know about Yonkers until yesterday. I don't think I sent a form in for that. Right?
You don't have a renewal in Yonkers.
No, it's in the mail. That's starting today. We're working on that today.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Okay, now let's go back. You said Yonkers had a lot of tapes.
I have to find out how many they have.
Okay. Well, then I shouldn't send this $8 to them?
In the future, when you get a new sponsor, are you gonna include postage to send them back?
Yeah, maybe. Can't tell about the future. But anyway, should I not send this $8 to Yonkers? Because you don't know how many tapes there are?
I'll have to email Wesley and see how many are there.
So shall I hold this $8?
If you want.
Okay. Then I'll send the $8 to War Pictures.
In a clear hope I'll send this thing in to recycle the tapes.
Oh. Well, you got them in Wappingers, right? You got tapes in Wappingers?
I'm just confused because your form says to recycle them.
Yeah, well, of course, I didn't talk to Taylor before he did that, and before I talked to you. When I talked to you yesterday, it made it all different. Can you return the tapes in Wappingers if I send Wappingers $8?
I'll check with Christine.
Oh, you want Taylor Holbrook to go all the way over?
I don't know where he lives.
He lives in Hopewell.
Okay, well, let me see how many are in Yonkers. I don't know.
We're still talking about Wappingers.
Okay, but you sent them a form to recycle them.
I did not. Taylor did.
Well, Taylor's a sponsor.
Yeah, but you got to understand that those are not Taylor's tapes. They're mine. And if you...
I assume Taylor, since he filled it out, got your approval.
No, he didn't.
Because you need to call Taylor and have him respond.
No, I'm not going to bother Taylor. He's a man of God doing good things, and he's already been bothered too much by this stuff. But if you throw away my tapes and Wappingers without my permission, that'll be another Rye Court.
Well, you better speak to Taylor.
Nope. I told you that already. Yes, see, it's one story, today is another. I want my tapes back from Wappingers. If you have 40 of them, I want them.
I don't know how many of them.
And I'll send them $8 to do it.
Huh?
Now, I can't read my writing on this next thing, on this list. Send the tape from the something. Do you know anything about that?
Send what?
Send the tape form. Okay, you sent the tape form to me, did you?
I didn't mail it yet. And I'll get picked up every couple days.
Okay. So when I get that form, see, I should have had that form before I sent out those renewals. And they could have done the whole thing together.
I sent them out to your sponsors weeks ago.
Yeah, and Angelo doesn't remember anything about it. I talked to him today.
Okay, listen, I have an editor on the other room.
Okay.
Help him with his graphics.
Oh, okay. And I talked to Ramage, and Ramage hasn't got your form yet. And Yonkers we're getting a signer for. And the damage tape, you're going to send it to me?
Yeah, I have to find postage unless I use one of your $3 and...
$8. It's only $1.42 to send it one tape back.
I know, but your sponsor from Peekskill said yesterday. I got.
Excuse me. You know what just happened? A bird just flew into my house.
Oh.
And I was watching him, and he got out okay. Now, what were you saying when I was watching the bird?
I believe I got Tybots yesterday.
You got what?
Form
that's
recycled tape for Peekskill.
Yeah, but I meant that to be maybe later. I didn't mean that to be now, because I sent you the money for that.
Okay.
Just a moment, the damage tape. No other cable system tells me that my tapes arrived damaged. I called them all up, I asked them, I got their answers on audio tape, and not one said. But this is the fifth or sixth time that Peekskill has said the tape is damaged when it comes in. Something's wrong. So I've asked for proof for her to send back the damaged tapes. I want to see it myself. And they never did. So here's another damaged tape, and I'm asking for it to be sent back to me.
It's my tape.
I know, Glendora. And if you want to know the sponsor, then have your private call me, and I'll speak with her about it.
Who?
Your Peekskill sponsor or your offering sponsor.
See, this is what mixed everybody up. There's no need of all this.
I know, but I have to go by the rules because this is my company.
I wouldn't own a company like that if I were you. Now, we're talking about Peekskill. So send me back Peekskill, please. And you have to...
I'll ask Christine.
Huh?
I will ask Christine.
Okay, let's see. I'm going to sue you. I'm going to sue...
Well, hang up now, Glendora.
And I'm going to sue Cablevision. I'm going to sue Charles Dolan. Did you ever see anything like this company? Boy, am I glad I got a recording of it. See, let me play this on the TV. Hold everything. Let me play it on the internet worldwide. We got a problem here.
So you see, folks, no matter what you try to do, and no matter how hard you try to reconcile and conciliate and cooperate with all of these things that they're doing that are totally illegal, no matter how hard you try, they've always got to block it. It's always got to be blocked. And it's the state law that a cable operator cannot limit or prohibit public access. Now, what do you call this, limiting and prohibiting public access? I'm on 44 cable TV systems. Not one of them is like this. So, I guess that's another lawsuit. They won't return my tapes. That was Cablevision Peekskill, County of Westchester, State of New York, and that was Cecilia Mastrilli. Why did they add this new form? You know, things were bad enough with the forms that they were making these poor people sign. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 pages they were making these people sign. And now they added another form about returning tapes. And tell me how that form can be a condition for not cable casting a chat with Glendora. How can that be a condition for violating free speech on a public forum?
I mean, it's what you call it, vicious. I just love them. You know why?
No, I want to know why.
Because they're electromagnetic waves. Can you imagine stuff? You and I can hear them or see them, but they're going right through the atmosphere into there.
I know that, but you know where else they're going?
Where?
In us.
in us?
Don't you think?
No, tell me what you mean. I don't think
I don't know. I guess maybe I'm older, you know, all those studies they've done and whatever.
Oh, I see that they hurt us. Oh, well, there's no question about that.
I think they do.
I say there's no question about that because... So dirty! Aren't they pretty, folks? They're Queen Anne's lace. Such a pretty flower. Set with Chatham TV. The chat with Glendora is being cable cast every Friday at 9 p.m. on Channel 7. And Natalia called them up and said, couldn't they stop it or censor it? Or is there a script that could be read? And she was referred to the supervisor, and he apparently took care of that. You know, you can't sue a cable company for something Glendora says, because the law is very clear on that. Glendora indemnifies the cable company. You can sue Glendora, but you cannot sue the cable company. That's Title 47 U.S. Code, Section 521 exec. I think it's up about around 545, section 545. Come, ye thankful people, come. Here you are, birdies in the meadow. Birdie, there's some food for you. Thank you, Dave Hertz.